Welcome, dear sixth grade students, in a new topic today of the surgery topics that you have this year.
This is Dr. Rizk, lecturer of general surgery, Zagazig University. Today I will discuss a topic that's a very popular or common complaint among patients. Many patients give this complaint, the complaint of anal fissure or piles. Before we study this topic, we must remember the embryology and anatomy of this region of the anal canal. We start studying this area because it will help us greatly in understanding the pathology and the treatment of these conditions. As we see on the monitor, there's a pouch in the pelvis of the embryo. This pouch is called cloaca, and this cloaca will later form the distal part of the urinary tract and the genital tract and the GIT, which is the rectum and anal canal. So this pouch has to be divided by a septum, like we see on the monitor. The septum divides into an anterior division called the urogenital sinus and a posterior division called ano-rectal sinus, which forms the rectum and the upper part of the anal canal. This septum is called urorectal septum. And the upper part of the ano-rectal sinus forms the rectum, and the lower part forms the upper two thirds of the anal canal.
طب واللور بارت جاي منه الابر تو ثيردس اوف ذا انال كانال.
امال اللور ذا لور وان ثيرد اوف ذا انال كانال از فورمد باي ذا بروكتوديرم اور ان ذا فينيشن اوف ذا بروكتوديرم which is present on the outside surface. It invaginates internally until it meets the lower two thirds of the anal canal forming from the ano-rectal. In the beginning, the proctoderm and the ano-rectal sinus are separated by a membrane which later disintegrates, so they become one continuous channel.
Distal part of the anal canal, distal one third, وبالتالي بيكوني continuous track زي ما احنا بنشوف قدامنا. الكونتينوس تراك دي الجزء الاكبر منها البروكسيمال.
So we end up with a common channel and the major portion of this channel, the upper two third, is from the inner rectal sinus and the lower smaller portion, the lower one third of the inner canal, is formed from top to bottom. That's why we say that the rectum and the upper two-thirds of the inner canal are endodermal in origin, while the lower one-third of the inner canal, which is from the proctoderm, is ectodermal in origin. Next, we move to the anatomy, the rectal anatomy, and we discuss some general features of the anatomy of the rectum. Rectum is the terminal part of the GIT, beginning at the level of the sacral piece and ending what centimeter below and in front. So it's about 15 centimeters in length.
بحيث ان هذه المسافة اللي هو طول الريكتم حوالي 15 سنتي. ده كده كان بالنسبة لجنرال ديسكريبشن. جزء تاني عاوزين نتكلم عليه في الجنرال ديسكريبشن ان هذا الريكتم
another feature of the rectum is that it's not a straight tube but its course shows curvature whether they're anteroposterior curvature or lateral curvature. If we examine the anteroposterior curvatures through a sagittal section dividing one person into two halves, you'll find that the person, as we see in the screen, the rectum, has one anteroposterior curvature. This curve is parallel to the sacrum, so it lies in the concavity of the sacrum. While we examine the rectum through coronal view, anteroposteriorly, we find that the rectum has a curve to the right side and then curves to the left side and then again to the right side. So the rectum has two right curvatures and one left curvature. There is clinical significance to these curvatures because in the inner aspect of the rectum, opposite these curvatures, there are mucosal protrusions called valves. These valves are in opposition to the curve, so the right curve has a left valve opposite the curve, while the left curve has a right valve opposite the curve. So there are two valves to the left side and one valve to the right side. These valves are called valve system, and their clinical significance is that there may be small lesions behind these valves. Okay, so when I'm examining the rectum through colonoscope, for example, I might miss these small lesions because they are hiding behind the valves, like a shelf, like the region above the valve form of the shelf, and the region is hiding behind it. It's a small lesion, so I might miss it while I am doing colonoscopy.
صعب شوية إنه ممكن يشوف. فأحيانا لو الليشنز دي صغيرة هنا في هذا المكان تبقى missed من الكولونوسكوبيك أو الإندوسكوبيك examination. دي كانت أهمية إن إحنا نتكلم على الفالفز أوف هيوستن. بعد كده
next we discuss the fascia and ligaments attached to the rectum or fixing the rectum. First is the vulvar fascia, which is a tough fascia attached extending from the posterior of the rectum. This layer may contain lymph nodes and extends posteriorly to the bony skeleton behind.
Extending it posterior to the bony skeleton behind. في another يعني another septum أو another fascial ligament طالع بقى من ال anterior surface.
Another fascia or septum attached to the anterior aspect of the rectum is what we call the denovir fascia. Denovir fascia. These two fascia are natural barriers. When there is malignancy, for example, inside the rectum and tries to extend to the outside, this fascia delay its extension to the outside, so it doesn't extend outside as easy. But this doesn't mean that they are impenetrable. They still can be penetrated, only penetration is delayed. There are also lateral rectum ligaments extending bilaterally from the sides of the rectum to the lateral pelvic wall. All these fascia ligaments have a function of fixation of the rectum. So when they are weakened, this promotes or predisposes to the prolapse of the rectum, which is another topic we are studying this year.
طبعاً شو هذا السبب الوحيد؟ ده بيبقى كو فاكتور من ضمن الأسباب اللي موجودة في هذا الباثولوجي. ده بالنسبة للفيشيال ليجمنتس. دلوقتي هنتكلم على
relations of the rectum.
إيه اللي حوالين الريكتم زي ما تعودنا ناخده في الأناتومي زمان. هنتكلم على أول حاجة
the anterior relations of the rectum differ between males and females naturally because the organs in the female pelvis are different than the organs in the male pelvis.
Organs of the pelvis of the male غير the pelvis of the female genital organs يعني التوزيع بتاعها مختلف فده بيخلي فيه شوية مختلفة فلو أنا بصيت على
if we examine the female pelvis as we see in front of us is the back of the uterus and the vagina as illustrated by the arrow
بالتحديد lower part of the uterus والback of the vagina دول يمثلوا the anterior relations of the rectum اللي ما بينهم بريتونيال باوتش مشهور جدا اسمه الدوغلاس باوتش
and then between them and the rectum there is the famous peritoneal pouch Douglas pouch which is an occasional site of collections
of the rectum اما بالنسبه لي الميل بيلفيس وهذا الميل بيلفيس
as for the male pelvis as we see in the second drawing and as illustrated by the arrow The anterior relationship of the rectum is the back of the renal rudder at the level of the trigon. Then more inferiorly, the back of the prostate and the seminal vesicles, representing the anterior relationships of the rectum.
اللي هي posterior aspect of this part of the male. ده بيخليني أقدر أقول.
So it means the urinary system is more exposed to the rectum than the females. While in females, the female genital organs form a barrier between the urinary system and the rectum. So in case of malignancy of the rectum in males, this malignancy can easily spread anteriorly to the urinary system, causing a fistula select. So the patient, the male patient may complain of stool appearing in urine. While in female patients, the urinary system is somewhat shielded from malignancy, So her complaint is a stool appearing from the vagina. So this is why the relationship of the rectum and the difference between males and females is significant. As for the posterior relationship, there is no difference between males and females. The sacrum. The coccyx and the part of the spinal floor and no difference between those sexes. Which also applies to the lateral relationships, the ligaments that we mentioned before, without any sex difference.
نتكلم على البلاد سبلاي اوف ذا ريكتام. البلاد سبلاي اوف ذا ريكتام، الريكتام بيجي له 3 بلاد فيزل، سواء 3 ارتريز اور 3.
As for blood supply of the rectum, the rectum is supplied by 3 blood vessels. Those are arteries or veins. Starting with the superior rectal vessels, which are continuation of the inferior enteric artery. The corresponding superior rectal vein continues as the inferior mesenteric vein, which joins the splenic vein. And as you know, the splenic vein joins the superior mesenteric vein to form the portal vein, which means that the superior rectal vein drains into the portal circulation.
السوبيريور ريكتال فين في البورتال سيركيوليشن. لما نكمل بقى بقيه الفيزلز عندي بعد كده الميدل
ريكتال از ذا ميدل ريكتال فيزل اور فيزلز ذا ميدل ريكتال ارتري رايزز فروم ذا انترنال ايليك ارتري وايز ذا ميدل ريكتال فين ذا تريبيوتري اوف ذا انترنال ايليك فين ريكتال ارتري First one is for the inferior rectal vessels. The inferior rectal artery is a branch of the internal mesenteric artery of the internal iliac artery. While the inferior rectal vein drains into the internal mesenteric vein, which is a tributary of the internal iliac vein. The
superior rectal vein بينتهي في portal circulation. أما the middle will inferior بينتهي عادي في system.
So this means the superior rectal vein drains into portal circulation, while the middle and inferior rectal vein drain into system circulation. Because it drains into the internal iliac vein, which joins the external iliac vein from the common iliac. So the rectal venous circulation is one of the points of proto-systemic communication, which we will discuss more details along with the anal canal. As for the lymph drainage of the rectum, lymph passes from the rectum into two different directions. Between the upper and lower part. The upper part drains in a different direction than the lower part. The upper part drains with lymphatics along the superior rectal vein, then the inferior mesenteric vein, up to the lymph nodes, the inferior mesenteric lymph nodes, which is part of the aortic group of lymph nodes, an abdominal group of lymph nodes. As for lymph drainage of the lower part of the rectum, they drain with the veins, the middle and inferior rectal veins, into the internal iliac lymph nodes, or the iliac group of lymph nodes. So in case of malignancy, according to the location of the tumor, I can expect which lymph node group will be drained by the malignancy, which I will need to resect during operation. So this is a part of lymph drainage with upper protein draining in a direction different than the lower
cell.
As for the nerve supply, the sympathetic supply comes from fibers passing along the superior rectal vessels. As for the parasympathetic supply, it reaches the rectum through the pelvic splenic nerve, which arises from S2-3 and 4 spinal segments. Of course, nerve supply is responsible for regulation of the motor function of the rectum, the contraction and peristalsis, which is an autonomic function.
وبكده احنا خدنا هنت هتساعدنا شويه في الاناتومي بتاع
الرئه. As for the anatomy of the anal canal as we see in the diagram in front of us.
بتاع الانال كانال. فالانال كانال بتبدا من حيث انتهى الريكتم 1 سنتيمتر in front of and below the tip of
the rectum. The anal canal starts where the rectum ends 1 سنتيمتر below and in front of the tip of the rectus and ends at the anal verge at the skin with the length about 4 سنتيمترs. And it's directed downwards and backwards. Next very important topic is the internal anatomy of the anal canal. This picture of the diagram is of the perspective of the anal canal from the inside. If I'm examining the anal canal from the inside, this is what I will see. I will see longitudinal mucosal elevations. These mucosal elevations or folds are called colons of Merkel-Morgagni. There are about 8 to 12 in number. Beneath these folds or projections, under each one of them, there is a branch of the superior rectal vessel, both the artery and the vein. Below the level of the columns of Morgagni, the mucosa forms a transverse crescentic fold, forming a line, an horizontal line passing along the whole circumference of the anal canal. These transverse crescentic valves are called the anal valves of Hall.
فولز اسمها
These folds are elevated area of the mucosa. So naturally, above these folds, there is a depressed area or a bed, which we call crypt, crypts of Morgagni. Or anal crypts or anal sinuses. These pits or crypts contain the openings of the anal canals, which are mucus secreting glands. Their mucus lubricates the passage of stool.
الاوبننج بتاعتها زي ما احنا بنشوفها بتظهر في الرسمه قدامنا دي دي الاوبننجز بتاعتها اللي هي الاوبننجز
اوف as for the placentic folds or the valves of wall they are anatomical landmark between the different embryological origins of the anal canal above them is the endodermal part while below them is the ectodermal part so this imaginary line passing through the valves of wall demarcating the transition between the two biologically different regions is what we call the bactinial line or dentate line.
بيمر بي ال valves of Bolt دي اللي احنا بنسميه dentate line او ساعات بنسميه bactinial line. ده لو انا بصيت على الانال كانال من جوه ببص عليها من الميكروس. نيجي الجزء الثاني مهم برضو نعرف عنه.
Another significant topic of the anal canal is the musculature of the anal canal.
زي ما احنا شايفين في الرسمه قدامنا ادي ده الريكتم اللي هو الجزء اللي فيه سيركيوليشنز دوت او كيرفيتشرز فوق وتحته الجزء الستريت ده الانال كانال عايزين نفهم الماسلز كنترولنج ذا موفمنت او ذا اكتيفيتي اوف ذا انال كانال الريكتم زي
ذا ريكتم لايك ان اذر بارتس اوف ذا جي اي تي اور انتستين هاف ان انر سيركولار اند اوتر لونجيتودينال ماسل لاير and the inner circular layer of the rectal muscles extend downward to surround the inner canal forming the inner sphincter.
بالمنظر ده كده وهي ديت اللي اسمها الانترنال سفنكتر يبقى الانترنال سفنكتر ما هي الا داونورد كونتينيويشن
سو ذا انر سفنكتر از اور انترنال انر سفنكتر از ا داونورد كونتينيويشن اوف ذا سيركولار ماسلز اوف ذا ريكتم
which lies
while the external inner sphincter is another circular muscle which lies to the outside of the internal inner sphincter. The external inner sphincter is formed of three parts, higher part and middle part and the lower part. The high part is called the deep part, the middle part is called superficial part, while the lower part which is immediately beneath the skin and attached to it is called the subcutaneous part. All three parts collectively form the external inner sphincter.
نبص بصة تاني عشان نفهم حاجة تاني. لو احنا بصينا ادي الانترنال سفنكتر وادي
there is a third muscle whose level above the level of the external sphincter called the fibrorectalis muscle as we see illustrated as two circles above the external sphincter This muscle is like a sling muscle. It starts anteriorly from the pubic bone and passes posteriorly to circumvent or surround the inner rectal junction and then passes anteriorly back again to the pubis, forming a sling-like structure.
تاني حاجة عاوز أقول اسمها نرجع تاني للريكتم. الريكتم عنده circular muscle fibers وعنده outer longitudinal muscle fibers زيه زي كل الجي اي تي. طيب وفي حاجه احنا كلنا عارفينها من الاناتومي اسمها البلفيك ديافرام اللي هي الليفيتور اناي ماسل اللي هي
another part that we know from anatomy is the outer longitudinal muscle layer of the rectum and there is also the muscle of the pelvic diaphragm or we call the levator inai muscle we find that the outer longitudinal muscle layer of the rectum becomes continuous
with the muscle fibers of the pelvic diaphragm together forming the muscle called the conjoined muscle
The conjoined longitudinal muscle.
هو بنشوفه قدامنا بيكون لي حاجة اسمها conjoined longitudinal muscle. conjoined longitudinal muscle دي اتحاد longitudinal muscle fibers of the rectum أثناء عبوره خلال البلفيك diaphragm. من هذه المسل.
All these muscles that we mentioned previously together, they form a complex muscle structure that collectively we call the ano-rectal ring. Involving part of the internal inner sphincter, a part of the external inner sphincter, and the puborectalis muscle, part of the pelvic diaphragm, and the longitudinal muscle of the rectum. All these muscles together form this complex muscular structure.
Components, زي ما احنا شايفين اللي متعلم عليهم بالدائرة الصفرة دي بتاعة الانو ريكتال رينج. الانو ريكتال رينج دي لما نبص على منظر اللي قدامنا الصورة بتاعة الريكتم.
This angle formed between the two different directions of the rectum and the anal canal. They form a natural block or restraint against the passage of contents, which is significant for continence.
لأنه لو حصل disruption في هذه الانوريكتال رينج,
any disruption of the anorectal ring, whether due to trauma or faulty surgical intervention,
may damage continence and the person becomes incontinent of feces.
The musculature of the anorectal junction. نخش بعد كده على ال blood supply. نفس الثلاثة vessels اللي هم كانوا بيحكوا.
As for the blood supply, the same three vessels that were supplying the rectum supply the anal canal.
And in the inner canal, we can distinguish the portosystemic anastomosis between the venous tributaries draining the venous the inner canal.
طبعا انا بعني الفينوس بارد, لان الفينوس بارد هو اللي ليه ديفرنشيت انتو بورتو وسيستميك, لكن الارتيريال ما فيش كده. الفينوس درينج بتاع الانال كانال بيحصل كونكشن
ذا كوميونيكيشن بتوين ذا بارت اوف ذا فينوس درينج اندينج انتو ذا بورتال سيركيليشن اند ذا بارت اندينج انتو ذا سيستم سيركيليشن فورمز تو بلكسس اوف فينس.
لما نبص عليهم
كولد هيمورويدال بلكسس.
الانال كانال اهو, وعندنا قدامنا هو ادي السوبيريور ريكتال فين بيبقى ماشي في
the tributaries of the superior rectal vein residing in the column of Mugagni and the tributaries of the middle rectal vein joined together forming the internal hemorrhoidal plexus or superior hemorrhoidal plexus, which is present above the level of the dentate line.
بعد كده
the superior rectal vein also gives the branches or tributaries a pass downwards along with branches of the middle rectal and the inferior rectal veins forming another plexus below called external hemorrhoidal plexus, which is very close to the anal verge, also called inferior hemorrhoidal plexus. Those plexuses are a site of portosystemic anastomosis.
كده يبقى احنا اتكلمنا على البلاد سبلاي. نيجي بقى الليمفاتيك
دريننج. As for lymphatic drainage, just like the rectum, lymphatic drainage passes into two different directions according to the location or level. With just a slight difference. The upper part of the inner canal, or the upper two cells, which is endodermal in origin, its lymphatic drainage passes with the middle rectal vein to the internal iliac vein or internal iliac group of lymph nodes. While the lower third, which is ectoderm in origin, its lymphatics, its lymphatic process with the lymphatics of the skin and the perineum to the inguinal lymph nodes. This is very significant because in case of malignancy of the upper inner canal, malignancy will spread through the superficial skin lymphatics to the inguinal lymph nodes and they will be enlarged. The inguinal lymph nodes can easily be assessed clinically as opposed to the internal iliac or the aortic group of lymph nodes. So it's very significant when I suspect malignancy of the inner canal, especially the lower part, to examine the inguinal lymph nodes to assess spread.
يبقى انا عندي الابر 2 ثيردز بيروح على الانترنال الياك واللور 1 ثيرد بيروح على الانجوين. نتكلم على النيرف سبلاي. برضو النيرف سبلاي هنا مهم جدا, لان الجزء اللي اباف الدنتيت لاين.
Next we discuss the nerve supply, which is very important. The upper two cells above the dentate line, which are in the dermal origin, are supplied by autonomic supply, just like the rectum. There is no somatic nerve supply, there is no somatic sensation, like sense of pain. As for the lower one third, which is supplied by somatic sensation by the surrounding skin, and it's very rich in supply of nerve endings, so it's very sensitive to pain in cases of injury.
Highly rich in free nerve endings, وبالتالي دوت بيخلي الجزء ده highly sensitive للبين. يبقى ده كده كان بالنسبة للنيرف سبلاي, وده بيخلينا بقى نقف وقفة ونقول ان ادي الانال كانال, وقدامنا الخط الازرق ده اللي هو يمثل مكان الدنتيت لاين اللي هو الخط المرسوم ما بين.
Here we have to pause and take an overview at the anatomy of the inner canal and the difference between the area above the dentate line and below the dentate line. The part above the dentate line is originated from the iron gut, which is endodermal, while the part below the dentate line is originated from the proctoderm, which is ectodermal. As for the lining, the upper part is supplied by GLT or lined by GLT mucosa or GLT epithelium, while the lower part is lined by modified skin devoid of keratin. As for the vein drainage, the upper part mainly drains into the portal circulation, while the lower part drains into skin circulation, but keeping in mind the communication between both circulations. As for the lymph drainage, the upper part drains mainly into pelvic lymph nodes, the iliac lymph nodes, while the lower part drains mainly into the inguinal lymph nodes. The lower part is supplied by somatic sensation, while the upper part is supplied by autonomic sensation or autonomic innervation. Next, the first subject of the first disease to discuss is the subject of anal fissure.
Anal fissure, that it is a wound, it is an ulcer in the lining of the anal canal.
An anal fissure is a wound or an ulcer in the lining of the anal canal. As for the cause of anal fissure, like the cause of any wound in any area, usually is trauma. And trauma in this area takes one of two forms. The first form is what we call direct trauma. And the cause of direct trauma may be foreign body. When swollen foreign bodies, like anal, for example, is swollen and then reaches the anal canal, causing injury. Or injury due to introduction of endoscope or enema nozzle, when performed inadequately or aggressively, can cause injury to the anal canal. When such procedures are done without adequate precautions or inadequate technique, they can cause injury to the lining of the anal canal and the fissure. A third possible cause of trauma is surgery, and the most famous surgery that can prevent the anal fissure is the surgery for piles. When we are performing surgery for piles, we are performing hemorrhoidectomy, we perform excision of the piles, and we remove part of the anal lining or the anal mucosa with the piles, which we will discuss in detail a little later. The fissure lies at the site of the impact or site of trauma. So in case of direct trauma, there is no specific site for fissure. The site of the fissure is just according to the trauma. There is no specific or common site for fissure due to direct trauma. The second form is the fissure due to indirect trauma, which is the more common form. What does it mean, indirect trauma? It means due to overstretching of the mucosa that results in tearing of the mucosa. Stretched by something like a hard, bulky stool. This is the most common incidence of indirect trauma for anal fissure. This animated figure illustrates the direction of stool passage to the anal canal. As you can see, it passes downward and backward. And as you can see from the arrow here, it impacts more on the posterior area of the anal canal. So the posterior wall of the anal canal is the one most more exposed to the trauma of a hard bulky stool due to its direction. The fissure in case of hard bulky or resulted from hard bulky stool will be in the posterior wall. Another form of overstretch of the anal canal, which occurs during vaginal delivery or normal labor. This is a diagrammatic presentation of a female in the lateral position. The upper circle is the vagina and the lower circle is the anal canal. During normal delivery, the vagina is stretched. So the anterior of the anal canal, which is in close relation to the vagina, is stretched as well. So the anterior wall is the site of impact and the site of fissure resulting from this trauma.
فهذا الفيشر هيحصل في الانتيريور وول اوف ذا انال كانال يبقى فيشر ان ذا بوستيريور
سو تو سم اب فيشر ان ذا بوستيريور وول اوف ذا انال كانال از فيري كاربوثرمونيك اوف كيسز ريزلتنج فروم كونستيبيشن واي انتيريور فيشرز ار كاربوثرمونيك فور كيسز ريزلتنج فروم فاجينال دريبر ممكن الاندايركت سمتايمز الاندايركت تروما كان ريزلت فروم ادفانسد اور برولابس بايلز that causes stretch of the anal mucosa outwards, so become more exposed to friction and trauma. Is trauma the only cause or only possible cause of anal fissure? No, sometimes there is another cause other than trauma, which is not a good sign. Most famously with inflammatory bowel disease, like Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Crohn's disease is more specifically more famous with oral ulcers and anal ulcers. And the resulting ulcers are usually on the lateral sides of the inner canal. So in case of detected fissures in the lateral aspect of the inner canal, it should not be taken lightly because it's usually a sign of a specific pathology that we should investigate.
يعني light causes like this, it is explained by more serious causes and you should search for it. تمام؟ يبقى ده بالنسبة لي الـ specific pathology. نخش بعد كده بقى على الأنواع الفشل.
Next we discuss different types of fissure. If a fissure is recently occurring, this is called the acute fissure. Which can either resolve spontaneously and naturally or progress to chronic form. Because of multiple factors present in this area that hinder healing. We need to examine the cause or the factors that cause a fissure to become chronic, and once it becomes chronic, it becomes more and more difficult to heal. Firstly, the presence of the wound in the anal region, which is very rich in the vein area, so the wound causes very severe pain. As a general rule in the human body, as you probably know, when there is an injury in a region in the body, a reflex spasm occurs in the nearby muscles, which is a protective reflex from the body in an attempt to prevent more injury of this area. So like any other part of the body, in case of inner fissure, reflex spasm occurs of the inner sphincter.
بيحصل عملنا الريتيشن للنيرف اندنجز بالوند فعمل لي الريفلكس ارك رجع عمل كونتراكشن للمسل. طيب لما حصل الريفلكس
ذا مسل اوف ذا انر سفنكتر از ا بارت وير ذا بلاد فيزلز باس ثرو تو ريتش ذا سب ميوكوزا اند ذا ميوكوزا سو ريفلكس سبازم كوز اوبستراكشن اور كونجيشن اوف ذوز فيزلز. This results in impaired blood flow reaching the mucosa and submucosa and the relative ischemia.
وصل الصاب ميوكوزا والميوكوزا هيبتدي يقل. يعني انا عملت ريلاتيف اسكيميا. واحنا كنا خدنا زمان في الجنرال سيرجري انه حاجه رئيسيه جدا للوند هيلينج ان يبقى فيه
اند از يو نو ان اني كيس وند فور انجري اسكيميا از ا فيري امبورتانت فاكتور ليدنج تو باد هيلينج.
يبقى الاسكيميا ده المسبب الرئيسي. طب في مسببات اخرى تخلي الوند ده يقعد وما يبقاش هيلد؟
Another factor is causing impaired healing. For example, the continuous passage of stool through the inner canal, which causes further mechanical injury or trauma, and biological injury by contamination of bacteria. So all these factors, ischemia with continuous mechanical trauma and continuous contamination, all together lead to impaired healing of inner fissure. When there is no healing, that means continuous pain, that means continuous reflex spasm, and so on, continuing in a vicious circle. In addition, the increased pain during defecation leads to the patient develops fear of defecation. He becomes afraid of defecation, so resulting in voluntary constipation.
الشخص بيعمل يعني ايه voluntarily constipation، هو ما بيبقاش عاوز يعمل defecation، فبالتالي بيحصل
constipation leads to stagnation of stool into the rectum and the sigmoid, which leads to more absorption of water and electrolytes, resulting into hardening of stool. And of course hard stool is more mechanically injurious to the mucosa.
معنى ان خليت الستول مور هارد يبقى خليته مور انجوريوس. مور انجوريوس لان لما تعدي على الوند حاجه سوفت غير لما تعدي عليه حاجه هارد، فاصبح الهارد ستول دوت ده سبب جديد بيخلي الوند از نوت هيل. المنظر
اللي احنا شايفينه ده في السيركل ذات وي ماست اندرستاند ذا بيجنت استرابت ان اند ذات وي ماست بريك فور ذا سيك اوف كيورينج ذا بيجنت.
طيب نخش نخش بعد كده على
next item is the complications in a fissure. What are the complications in a fissure? Like mentioned, the first complication is chronicity.
وارد جدا ان هو يتحول من الاكيوت للكرونيك فورم واحنا شرحنا القصه دي
دلوقتي. Next complication is perineal infections. The fissure is an injury in the mucosa. The mucosa is a protective layer, a natural protective layer against organisms, bacteria and infectious agents. When there is injury of the mucosa, the bacteria can pass into the adjacent tissues, causing perineal suppuration, perineal abscess and infection. Next complication is the continuous irritation of the perineal area due to increased mucus secretions, which is also a reflex, due to irritation by the fissure. Some mucosal secretions are increased, leading to irritation of surrounding skin and the eczema. There is the increased itching sensation or pruritus. Naturally, the patient can develop irritability and insomnia due to continuous pain and irritation.
الشخص ده بيبقى يعني بيوصل لحاله من الارتباتي تصل الى مرحله عدم النوم انه مش عارف ينام كويس بسبب البين اللي موجود عنده انسوميا اند نيرفسنس اند ارتباتي. ساعات هذا البين بقى يبتدي يبقى ريفلكتد على النيبورنج اريا ويعمل لي بين.
سام تايم اوزو ذا بين كان ريفلكت اون ذا نيبورنج اريا كوزينج فور اكزامبل ديسيوريا ديفيكولتي اور بين ديورينج ماتيريشن ديسبارونيا بين ديورينج سيكشوال انتركورس ديسمينوريا ويتش از بين ديورينج ماتيريشن. All are reflex responses from the body, something like river pain due to irritation of the nerve supply of the pelvis.
عنده هذه complications with different forms of pain related to the pelvic functions.
Next, we discuss the clinical picture of the patient with inner pressure. The clinical picture, of course, the first symptom is pain. Pain is the first and the main complaint of the patient.
The fissure patient comes to your clinic complaining of pain, anal pain. دي الكومبلينت بتاعك. البين ده بيبقى related للديفيكيشن
pain occurs during the defecation but continues after defecation for variable durations. Some patient may say that the pain lasts for about an hour after defecation. Another patient might say that it lasts for 5 hours. Another patient might say it lasts all day, resulting in fear of defecation. The next possible presentation is bleeding, which is not a common complaint in this venous fissure. And if occurs, we must pause at this presentation. Usually, it's in the form of small or minute drops of blood. If bleeding is thick, then that means that the cause is not anal fissure. Anal fissure patient might present with minute bleeding, but not excessive bleeding. So that means that there is another cause other than the fissure. Third symptom is perineal itching, like we discussed before. But always remember that the first and the main complication is pain. Or the patient may present during examination with picture of complications. What about the signs of examination? The sign in case of acute fissure, we only use our eyes. The lower end of the fissure can be seen. The second sign that we can see is due to the anal spasm of the anal sphincter, there is increased corrugation or puckering of the skin, so there is what we call exaggeration of the anal corrugation around the anal canal.
Circumference of the muscle coat صغر بسبب الاسباس فعمل كشكشه للجلد ده فخلى الكوري فدي ساين لما بشوفها
بعينيا. So these are the diagnostic signs of anal fissure, either to see the lower end of the fissure or see the reflex exaggerated anal corrugations due to spasm. One thing to very important thing to remember, never try to insert your finger inside the anal canal in case of acute anal fissure because this is very painful to the patient.
The duty of the doctor is not to cause pain.
You are supposed to relieve pain, not cause pain. So again, it's prohibited to insert your finger and to do a rectal exam in case of acute anal fissure. Just as the patient's complaint and my eyes, I diagnose the case. As for the case of chronic anal fissure, this is we use our eyes and our fingers because the chronic fissure patient can tolerate the palpation. In chronic fissure, I am supposed to be looking for something called fissure triad. As this triad includes the fissure itself, as we can see, I may not be able to distinguish the fissure with my eyes, but I can feel it with palpation because the fissure is chronic and fibrosed. The floor is fibrosed, so I can feel it like a hardened ridge or an indurated ridge. At the lower end of the fissure, or at the outside, we see something, a skin tank, which we call a sentinel pile. It's called sentinel pile because it resembles the pile that we are going to discuss a little later, but they don't have the same pathology. They are just a skin tag resulting from the fissure. So it's just a skin tag, and that has no similar composition or similar pathology to the pile disease that we are going to discuss in a little while. The third component of the fissure triad is at the upper end of the fissure. The anal gland becomes hypertrophied and forms a hypertrophied papilla. So these three components of the fissure triad are the diagnostic criteria of chronic fissure. So to sum up, fissure is diagnosed with the patient's complaint, pain, mainly the non-complaint, and sometimes a few drops of blood, along with the examination, whether the criteria of acute fissure or chronic fissure. So by these three items only I diagnose the case. There is no place for investigation to diagnose an anal fissure. Anal fissure is a clinical diagnosis. Investigations are only needed when I am suspecting a specific pathology causing the fissure, like Crohn's disease.
Now we move to treatment. Treatment can be medical or surgical. Medical treatment can be very efficient and successful in case of acute anal fissure. Acute anal fissure is mainly a medically managed problem. Medical treatment can also be attempted with patients of chronic anal fissure and might give some relief in the beginning. What is the medical treatment? To understand the medical treatment, we return to the vicious cycles that we discussed before. Medical treatment relies on breaking the components of this cycle. The first component of this cycle that I should try to cure with drugs is severe pain. So the first item in my prescription for the anal fissure patient is analgesic. Whether the analgesic is systemic through oral or injection route, or local through creams or ointments or suppositories. Because pain is the trigger of the whole event, so analgesic is the primary item in medication. The next component that I can deal with is hard stool. Hard stool is dealt with through laxatives. When prescribing a laxative, I have to be cautious not to give an excess dose that induces diarrhea. And diarrhea, although it's a soft stool, but repeated and increased frequency of defecation means increased trauma, even if it's more soft trauma, but repetition causes more injury. So diarrhea will be just as injurious as constipation. So I don't want to induce diarrhea, nor do I want to under-treat the patient, keeping him in constipation. I want to keep the patient's motions with average consistency and frequency. The third component of my prescription is to deal with the reflex muscle spasm. So I give agents that induce muscle relaxation. Whether by physiological agents like instructing the patient to sit in warm bath, or a topical muscle relaxant, which is a group of creams that can induce muscle relaxation. The purpose of these creams is to relax the internal anal sphincter and so improve the blood supply of the mucosa and submucosa and improve healing. So any prescription for the anal fissure patient must control these three components, whether through local or systemic routes.
يبقى دول الثلاث كومبوننتس والثلاث محاور اللي انا بتحرك عليهم في الميديكال تريتمنت. لكن متى ما انا قررت بقى ان انا هعالج
But once I decide that I am going to use surgical approach with the patient, which component of the cycle that I can deal with surgically, I can deal with heart stool or pain surgically, but I can deal with the reflex spasm. The muscle spasm which I can deal with a surgical procedure. What is the surgical procedure? The procedure is anal dilatation. Under general anesthesia, I insert my fingers into the anal canal. I start with one finger gradually, and then once the anal canal accommodates it, I insert a second finger, and then up to four fingers gradually. Must be gradually so as not to cause muscle rupture. This gradual stretch of the muscle causes muscle exhaustion, so it eliminates the muscle spasm. But the problem with anal dilatation is that it affects only temporary, and then spasm recurs again. Anal dilatation is only resort to in case of acute anal fissure not responding efficiently to medical treatment. Otherwise, I need to perform a procedure with more permanent effect, which is sphincterotomy, which means cutting of the muscles. Sphincterotomy can be performed in one of two ways. The first way or the first method, as we can see in the illustration in front of us, this is the mucosa, and beneath the mucosa is the internal sphincter, and deeper to the internal sphincter is the external sphincter. While the fissure is present posteriorly, as we see below. The procedure is to cut off the internal sphincter, which is the circle that we see in the middle. I can either approach the internal sphincter from the lateral aspect, as we see here in the diagram, this short white line. This is where I perform the incision. And right next to me is the internal sphincter, so I cut it as you see here in the drawing. And so release of the spasm occurs. Of course, I cut the muscle within certain limits. I don't cut the excessive amount or excessive depth of muscle so as not to cause incontinence. So I just cut within a certain length only. You don't have to discuss the details for your undergraduate level. While the second approach is posterior sphincterotomy. In cases where the fissure is very chronic, that it became fibrosed, even if sphincterotomy is performed and the blood supply to the mucosa is improved, the edges of the fissure are still unhealthy and cannot induce the required healing. Because of fibrosis, edges are fibrosed, so they never have fresh or healthy epithelium. So I need to do excision of the whole fibrosed fissure so as to allow healing from healthy mucosa. So I turn or I convert the fissure into a new fresh wound. And after I excise the fissure, right beneath me is the internal sphincter. So I continue to do sphincterotomy from that approach, and that's what's called posterior sphincterotomy. So sphincterotomy can be either lateral or posterior. Lateral sphincterotomy, since the mucosa is not open, I do sphincterotomy through an incision in the skin from the outside, so it's called sometimes closed sphincterotomy. While posterior sphincterotomy, because I excise the fissure, I open the mucosa, so it's called open sphincterotomy. And that concludes the surgical management of fissure. Now we move to the next subject to discuss today, which is hemorrhoids, which is the second very important subject. The definition of hemorrhoids is the varicosities occurring in the hemorrhoidal plexus, either external or internal plexus. Such as any varicosities occurring in any other part of the body, like varicosities of the lower limbs, or varicosities of the bimaniform plexus of veins in the patients with varicocele. They are formed of dilatation or engorgement of the veins, which become engorged with blood. And the cause of hemorrhoids are just like the cause of varicosities in any other parts of the body. So the cause of varicosities that apply here apply to any other varicosities in the body. Either due to an inherited or inherent problem in the veins in this area, which is called primary varicosis. As we can see here in the diagram of the anal canal and the two plexus, where hemorrhoids originate. They can be from the internal hemorrhoidal plexus, which are called internal piles, or from the external hemorrhoidal plexus called external piles.
So what are the causes of this condition? The causes are just like I said, either inherent causes in the veins in this area where there is no other causes, so these are called the primary hemorrhoids. Maybe predisposed by weakness of the venous wall. Usually a component of a condition of the patient called the mesodermal weakness, a generalized condition of the patient. This patient loses the natural ability to pump blood, so when the vein becomes engorged with blood, it becomes dilated and doesn't return back to its normal tone and diameter. And also adds to the condition the fact that the portal veins are valves. So backflow is more common and leads to stagnation in the most dependent veins. Because there are no valves that keep the blood moving in one direction, no, the blood can all the time regurgitate back and accumulate and stagnate in this area. Another factor is that the support from the surrounding tissue is not strong enough. The surrounding tissue is not strong, it's weak, not providing adequate support. One last thing we noticed in patients with frequent constipation, constipation itself compresses the drainage of veins, and with repeated straining, during the straining, the muscle contraction during straining compresses the veins, impairing its drainage, leading to accumulation of blood and precipitation of this problem on the long run.
ده على اللونج ران بيروح عامل هذه المشكله. يبقى دي الاسباب البرايمري اللي قدامنا اللي هي بتعمل
هذا. So those are the primary causes, or those are the causes of primary hemorrhoids, but there may be a specific pathology causing what we call secondary hemorrhoids. And secondary causes are just like the cause of secondary varicosities in another area of the blood. We examine the parts of blood from the area of these veins up to the right side of the heart. If obstruction occurs anywhere along this path, it will lead to stagnation of blood proximal to the site of obstruction, leading to varicosities. The obstruction may be at the level of the heart itself, in case of congestive heart failure, for example, or pulmonary embolism. In this case, may precipitate piles or varicosities on the other side of the body. Obstruction may be at the level of the liver or the level of the portal circulation itself. The patient important of portal hypertension, they have backflow of the portal circulation also presenting this problem. Obstruction may also be at the level of the pelvis itself, in case as the cases of pelvic mass, pelvic tumors, or more famously pregnancy. Pregnancy is a physiological mass compressing the veins. So it's very common occurrence that we meet patients that didn't have hemorrhoids, and then after becoming pregnant, she developed hemorrhoids. Because the uterus compresses the iliac veins, as we remember, two of the draining veins of the iliac canal end in the iliac vein. So compression of the iliac vein leads to stagnation of blood into the hemorrhoidal plexus, into hemorrhoids. And we assure these patients that after the pregnancy is ended, the condition will resolve spontaneously when venous fluids return to normal. Obstruction can also occur at the, or occurring at the level of the rectum itself, because rectal mass compressing the veins in the wall of the rectum leading to congestion into the hemorrhoidal plexus. So those are the causes of secondary hemorrhoids, secondary causes of piles.
Specific cause, المشكلة مش على قد weakness في الwall of the vein والحاجات دي. طيب ده كده كان بالنسبة للكوز.
Now we move to the pathology of piles.
لو احنا بصينا زي ما بيظهر قدامنا كده شكل الانال كنال.
Imagine the circle as the inner canal in a certain position. Usually any circular structure in the body, when you try to define locations in the structure, we deal with it as a clock. We use the analogy of a clock. So we determine the sites according to like the numbers in a clock. For example, the anterior is 12 o'clock, while posterior is 6 o'clock, and so on. So in case of piles, piles usually occur in the form of three main piles. The first one is the level of the 3 o'clock. The second one is the level of 7 o'clock. And the third one is the level of 11 o'clock.
كما لو ان لقينا الكنال السيركل دي ساعة، وانا ده مكان الساعة 3، ده مكان الساعة 1، ده مكان الساعة 4، ففي واحدة عندي 3 و7 و11. بنلاحظ ان ساعات بيحصل فيه بقى أربعة صغيرين كمان بنسميهم
sometimes smaller piles that we call daughter piles, four daughter piles, and an even smaller one that we call one grand daughter pile can appear. May appear between the three main ones. Here we are discussing the piles that originate mainly from the internal hemorrhoidal plexus, or what we call internal piles. When we examine one of these internal piles, we find the condition is that a sac of mucosa containing a collection of dilated veins or dilated venous channels surrounding a single center of the artery.
مليانة بديليتد فينوس تشانلز وفي النص فيه سنترال ارتريو. طيب هذه البايل ماس لو انا بصيت عليها بتبقى
when we examine the piles we find that it's a mass that's hanging down from the anal canal with a pedicle that's attached at the level of the dentate line. Naturally because above the dentate line is the site of the internal hemorrhoidal plexus which we mentioned is the origin of most cases of piles. As we see here, this is the appearance of internal piles. As for the external piles, this piles result from ruptured venule of the external hemorrhoidal plexus. So they are not dilated veins, they are ruptured vein causing a collection of blood, hematoma. This hematoma causes swelling or projection at the anal verge. Submucosal hematoma.
Collection تحت الميكوزا فعمل لي projection من الميكوزا عند الانال verge. دي الاكسترنال بايل. سو الاكسترنال بايل موستلي مش دايليتد فينز، رابشر ذا فين ليدنج تو هيماتوما سب ميوكوزال هيماتوما.
This is usually precipitated in patients with chronic cough. So with each attack of cough there is elevation of the venous pressure and in one attack the vein might rupture causing hematoma.
هذا الرابشر. يبقى ده بالنسبه للباثولوجي زي ما احنا شايفينه قدامنا اهو بيحصل ازاي هذه الهيمورويد. نيجي بقى للكومبليكيشن.
Next we move to the complications of piles. The first complication is that it's a blood losing source, it's a source of blood loss. Any patient with a cause of blood loss may present with iron deficiency anemia, which may be the first presentation of the patient that he seeks medical advice from internal medicine doctor for symptoms of anemia. Another possible complication is that this mass or pile by its weight can drag the mucosa and collapse outside and may even cause prolapse of the wall of the rectum, but usually it's only partial prolapse of the mucosa, not complete prolapse. Prolapse of the rectum is a rare occurrence in case of piles, but it's possible. Also, these veins with unhealthy wall may develop inflammation causing what we call thrombophlebitis. And also thrombosis may occur inside these veins due to the stagnation and an unhealthy wall causing thrombose the piles. Lastly, this pile, this the mass that's hanging down or collapsed may undergo twisting of its pedicle. This pedicle contains a supplying blood vessel. So if it's twisted, this can cause obstruction of the vessels causing strangulation. Like in the case of strangulation of hernia or any structure with twisting its pedicle, this strangulation can predispose to necrosis and gangrene.
أكيد خدتوا الاسترانجوليشن كواحدة من ضمن الكومبليكيشن اللي بتحصل في الهرنيا، فأنتوا فاكرين من موضوع الهرنيا فأكيد الاسم ده مش غريب عليكم. وبالتالي لما نيجي نتكلم
So when we discuss the clinical picture of this patient or have the patient present, the first symptom that the patient presents with is fresh bleeding. This is characteristic of piles. The first and main symptom and most common symptom is fresh bleeding and usually painless fresh bleeding. Fresh meaning that the blood is bright red blood, not altered blood, not digested or discolored blood. Maybe 50 cc of blood or more. The complaint may be the mass itself. The patient complains of the mass, prolapsed mass, but also usually painless mass. Occasionally, because of irritation of the mucosa, as the anal mucosa, the patient may complain of perianal itching and pruritus, but also still the main complaint is fresh bleeding or painlessness. One thing we must remember is that the patient of non-complicated bile never presents with pain. Pain means complication. A non-complicated bile never presents with pain. The presence of pain, these are due to complication or the presence of another pathology, associated pathology, like fissure, for example. And this is very common for patients to present with fissure and pies at the same time. Or if the pie is complicated with a complication causing pain, like thrombosis of the pile or strangulation. Again, we repeat, a patient with piles, pure piles with no secondary pathology or complications never presents with pain. Because this is a misconception or confusion in the popular culture, the patient presents with pain and people say that he has piles. Pain is a manifestation of fissure, not piles, again, remember. And the presence of pain and piles means either complication or an associated secondary pathology. We must be careful when we are hearing the patient's complaint, not to let the patient delude us with his misconceptions. Then we move to examination of the patient. By examination, the piles has 4 degrees. Three of them can be seen with the naked eye, except the first one cannot be seen with the naked eye. The first degree means there is dilatation of the veins, pushing the mucosa, causing elevation of the mucosa, but they are still in normal site in a canal, so they cannot be seen with the eyes, they can only be examined with proctoscope. The second degree is when the veins are dilated or the mass is enlarged enough that when the patient strains, it's pushed outside the inner canal and can be seen with the naked eye. But when the patient stops straining or relaxes, the piles are retracted again or reduced again inside the inner canal. So they are reduced spontaneously. The third degree is similar to the second degree, except that the pile is not reduced spontaneously. The patient has to reduce the pile manually or has to push the piles back inside the inner canal manually. The fourth degree is when the piles are protruded outside the inner canal all the time and cannot be retracted, cannot be reduced inside the inner canal. So the second, third, and fourth degrees of piles can be seen and diagnosed with the naked eye. The first degree cannot be seen with the naked eye if the patient presents with bleeding from the inner canal and they cannot see the pathology. I mean it to perform a proctoscope so as to find the piles or the mass. Another criteria is that the piles are painless and not tender. If the piles are tender, that means they are complicated, or that they are not piles, that this is a different pathology. Very important remark to remember is that you must perform PR examination, because many patients present with pile or a pathology similar to pile, but with PR examination, we reveal something other than pile, a secondary pathology like a tumor, rectal tumor, or rectal mass. So I shouldn't be distracted with treating the patient's piles while the patient has a second pathology, more serious pathology like malignancy, and I neglect the more significant pathology for the sake of piles. Until the malignancy has become too advanced, while it could have been treated if discovered early. So it's very important to perform manual examination or PR examination to exclude other pathology. Always remember that the piles may be just a secondary pathology. So this is a clinical picture of piles, and it's also just a clinical diagnosis. Investigation like rotoscope is only in case of first degree piles. As for lines of treatment of piles, treatment can be medical or can be interventional, using interventional methods like injection therapy, rubber band ligation, cryotherapy, laser or infrared photocoagulation, and lastly, surgical intervention. First, the medical treatment. What are the indications of medical treatment or treating piles medically? The first indication is in case of first and second degree piles. First and second degree piles are treated mainly by drugs or medications. Another indication is in case of secondary piles, piles that are secondary to another cause, like secondary to venous congestion, like heart failure or portal hypertension. So in such cases, I just need to treat the cause and the piles will resolve spontaneously. So this is the indication of medical treatment. The third indication is in cases of complicated like thrombosis and inflamed piles. These cases must be treated medically first, must treat the thrombosis or inflammation before proceeding to further intervention. So what are the components of medical treatment? The first component is treatment of the cause and constipation, treatment of the cause in secondary piles. And even in primary piles, constipation is the main predisposing factor. Like I mentioned before, the repeated frequent or severe straining and muscle contraction is the predisposing factor to venous congestion and occurrence of piles, even in primary piles. Another component in patients with inherent weakness in the venous wall, we may recognize these patients by giving history of pathology like hernia or varicose veins in the legs. And these patients, we may give factors that cause contraction or strength in the venous wall called venotonics. Lastly, there are, of course, antibiotics given for cases of inflammation, and local agents, which are a collection of creams given locally, which may be analgesics or anti-dentous creams or containing corticosteroids. With medical treatment, the first and second degree piles usually are sufficient to treat or resolve the condition. In case of failure of medical treatment, then we resort to other methods or other interventions. First intervention is injection sclerotherapy. What are the indications of injection sclerotherapy? It's indicated in non-complicated first and second degree piles when the patient has active bleeding. Injection sclerotherapy in this case is a rapid intervention, effective intervention. When there's active bleeding, there is no time to prepare the patient for surgery, or you can't wait for medical treatment to be effective while the patient is in bleed. Just like the same logic in case of bleeding with esophageal varices. Another indication is when the patient already had surgery for piles and recurrence occurs, in case of recurrence after surgery. A third indication is when the patient is an old, unfit for surgery. In these cases, I resort to sclerotherapy. How is this technique performed? As we see in the diagram, this is the inner canal. I examine the inner canal or reveal the inside of the inner canal using the ductoscope. And I use a syringe filled with sclerosant material injected inside the pile. The needle is introduced beneath the mucosa in the submucosal area. And the sclerosant material is phenol almond oil. The most important thing to remember is that the material is injected in the submucous plane around or surrounding the dilated veins because they induce fibrosis, and this fibrosis compresses and obliterates the dilated veins. As we see here in the illustration, the piles begin to shrink until they disappear. Now, of course, this technique has possible complications. What are the complications? The first complication, when I'm using a needle introduced through an unhealthy surface or contaminated surface, so naturally infection is possible. I can transmit infection to inside the tissue. Another possible complication in case of multiple injections at multiple points, they may result in excessive fibrosis leading to compression on the inner canal itself or the circumference of the inner canal leading to stricture or stenosis. Also, in case of injections, the fibrosis in the injected area might lead to compressing of the vasculature of this area itself to the degree that it causes ischemia of the mucosa and ulceration. Another possible complication in case the needle is introduced too deep, you may accidentally cause injection in further areas, like the prostate, causing prostatitis in males. So after medical treatment and after injection sclerotherapy, another approach that we discuss is rubber band ligation. Rubber band ligation can only be used in non-complicated second-degree piles, because for it to be effective, the piles must have a pedicle for the rubber band to close. The rubber band must have applied to the pedicle of the piles. So it can be used with the first degree pile, because the first degree pile doesn't have a pedicle, it's just a mess inside the inner canal. An advantage of this technique is that it can be used in patient who is unfit for surgery or unfit for anesthesia, because it's not a surgery, it can be done as just an outpatient procedure without anesthesia or. As we see here in the diagram, the rubber band, which is a rubber ring, is applied with a special introducer around the pedicle of the pile. So, when the it's rubber, it will compress the pedicle, leading to its constriction and obliteration of the pile. Now, due to obstruction of the blood supply of the pile later becomes sloughed. What about the complications of this maneuver? The first complication is when this pile is sloughed, it may result in ulceration and bleeding. Another possible disadvantage is that the vein might slip from the pedicle. The patient may come second or third day after operation saying that he found the band in his tool. Another route that the procedure failed. The band wasn't fixed in its place. The next possible intervention is cryotherapy. Cryotherapy is a procedure that can be used in non-complicated degree of pain, especially in old or unfit patients, and can also be used as an outpatient procedure. And can be applied to any degree of pain. The technique of cryotherapy is that after local infiltration with local anesthesia, I apply a probe, a special cryotherapy probe. In this probe, the probe passes freezing nitrogen. This is the freezing substance. This freezing nitrogen causes freezing up to necrosis of the tissue. When the probe is applied, the pile starts to freeze and shrink and become bluish in color due to freezing, and then later it sloughs. What is the complication or disadvantage of this procedure? The first complication is that this frozen necrotic pile may induce excessive mucoid discharge, offensive mucoid discharge, for lasting for weeks, causing excessive wetting or excessive swelling of the underwear, which may be distressing and annoying to the patient.
Offensive discharge جدا في حاجة annoying للبيشن. ده بالنسبة للكريوثيرابي.
The fourth possible intervention is laser or infrared photoradiation. Infrared photoradiation is done by applying an infrared probe that causes heat coagulation or coagulative necrosis by heat of the tissues and which later sloughs. While the application of the laser relies on acting on the intima of the blood vessels, it makes the intima sticky and adherent, so the blood vessel collapses and the intima stick together, the blood vessel becomes obliterated or obstructed. But this idea didn't mean clarity. Laser application in pile wasn't very popular. Now the last possible solution is a surgical solution. And when do we decide to resort to surgical intervention? The first indication is in case of third or first degree pain. Because in third and first degree pain, the medical intervention or medical treatment is usually not effective. And the other methods of intervention are usually also not very successful. Or surgery is resorted to in case of failure of other methods or recurrence after other methods. Another indication is when the patient has another pathology, like fissure, for example, that requires surgery. So surgery is done for the other pathology and the pies in the same setting. What is the technique or what is the idea of surgical hemorrhoidectomy? The idea is that I use, I dissect around the pile with the ischemic probe, as you see in the screen. I dissect the pile and free it from the underlying tissue all around until it's hanging by the pedicle. And then I ligate the pedicle and excise the pile. After excision of the pile, aero surface is left behind, as you can see on the screen. Release the pile or the pile bed. It's important to be cautious when removing the pile, not to remove excess area of mucosa or leave an excess area or excess raw area, so as to leave enough amount of penicillin to allow healing. So if the patient has multiple piles, I may not be able to perform excision of all the piles in the same setting. If I remove them all in the same setting, I will not be leaving enough penicillin for healing, so it may result into fibrosis and stenosis of the inner canal. Which brings us to the complications of surgical hemorrhoidectomy. The first complication is the suture that's obliterating the pedicle is slipped. This results in bleeding postoperative in the first 24 hours, which we call the reaction hemorrhage, the very aggressive bleeding. Bleeding also occurs within the first 2 weeks after surgery due to infection in this contaminated area. Infection of the vascular stump may lead to bleeding, which we call secondary hemorrhage. So bleeding is a famous complication of hemorrhoidectomy, but still it's a manageable complication. Can be dealt with. But the second famous complication is reflex urine retention, which occurs reflexly secondary to pain. We can start the trial dealing with preservative, like applying warm bags to the pelvic area of the patient. And the field, of course, we must insert a urinary catheter. The third complication that we mentioned earlier is in case I need excess mucosa, we will not leave sufficient mycelium to regenerate and line the circumference of the anal canal. The patient may suffer from fibrosis and stenosis, which will be very difficult to correct. Correction of anal stenosis is a very difficult advanced procedure. Another possible complication is incontinence. In case I remove excess or cross-cutting of excess muscle of the internal sphincter, as we mentioned before, we may intentionally remove part of the internal sphincter to treat fissure and to allow healing, but if I remove an excess amount of muscle, this may lead to incontinence. And the last complication is fissure, because the excision of pile is when I remove the mucosa with the pile, I perform an artificial fissure. Or iatrogenic fissure. That's why I perform sphincterotomy with the operations to allow healing. But if healing didn't occur properly, this may result in residual fissure. So this concludes the surgical complications of hemorrhoidectomy and concludes the subject of piles and the fissure and the subject of today. So best of luck with the topics of general surgery, and I hope you enjoy them. And you are welcome to present any questions through our official page. And we will reply to you whether in writing or through similar live sessions. And best of luck. And we wish you a happy year and good luck in your examinations.